We're basing this first PBA World Tour magazine tape around the opening Grand Slam event of the 1991 PBA World Tour in Almenar-Yerres, France. The Fanatic Tessier Grand Slam with its $150,000 in prize money and double World Cup points is a real must for all the top professionals, including, of course, reigning world champion Bjorn Dunkerbeck from Spain. He trained all winter on his native island of Gran Canaria and now encounters his opposition for the first time in several months.
Well, I think the toughest guys to beat this year will basically be the same as last year, like top guys like Anders, Robbie, Robert, Patrice. Maybe a few other guys who train hard this winter who have good equipment, better equipment than last year, who have more experience than last year, will come up during the year. But we are still at the very beginning and I'm not quite sure who trained where and how much they train, so it's hard for me to say.
It's hard to tell how it's going to turn out. I'm quite sure that at the end of the day, it will be a lot more attractive to me than what last year was. And just waiting for it to see it materialize, because I've had a really busy winter where I've been working a lot with my material. But unfortunately, I've been doing the whole job alone, and it's very tricky saying if it's going to be faster or not really.
I think catching Bjorn is for sure not going to be easy overall. He's got very fast equipment that he knows very well. And if the conditions are right for his size, it's kind of hard for someone my size to beat him. But I don't think it's impossible, and I'm going to give it a hell of a shot.
All the girls are my competitors that race, actually, and there's a few of them that are good, that can do very good this year, which is Jutta Müller, Barbara Kendall, Andrea Cochran, Natalie Siebel in the waves, and Jessica Crisp for sure.
I'm on really good equipment this year, and I grew up on a longboard. I started with course racing, because that's what we can do in Germany most of the time. And so I used to be really good on a longboard, but all the last years I didn't have very good equipment, so I wasn't that competitive. And now it looks like I have good stuff and can be in front, maybe.
It should be good. I just hope we get a lot of wind. And I just like racing. I don't like sitting around. So I'd prefer to be out there doing something.
Maui is not only the playground for gentle giants, but also for the not-so-gentle windsurfing pros battling it out for the final honours in the 1990 PBA World Tour at the Peter Stuyvesant Travel Aloha Classic. So let's look back and see what happened at last year's most important Grand Slam event. In the women's slalom, it was a close call between Britt Dunkerbeck, Angela Cochran, and Barbara Kendall. But in the final, Angela Cochran wipes out, while Barbara Kendall is doing better. In the end, it's Britt Dunkerbeck who wins the slalom discipline here in Hawaii and takes the slalom world championship title. The men's slalom final is a real showdown between Anders Bringdahl and Bjorn Dunkerbeck. Both men were at each other's throats for most of the year, culminating the very exciting final. Bringdahl takes the honours at the Peter Stuyvesant Travel Aloha Classic, but second place here is enough for Dunkerbeck to ensure him the Slalom World Championship of 1990. An unusual scene at Hoogkeeper, the temple of wave riding, is the start of a course race. Again, we see a major clash between Anders Bringdahl and Bjørn Dunkerbeck, with the latter having the edge, winning the course race discipline here and thus taking the course racing world championship as well. Barbara Kendall finds her form to win the course race discipline at the Aloha Classic, but Britt Dunkerbeck's third place is still enough to win her the course race world championship of 1990.
Think they come here and swarm our beaches and like a bunch of mosquitoes. And I think they should go home, go back to where they came from.
A lot of them can't see too good and they always run over people out there. They fucking do a big loop right over us, almost kill me a couple times.
On Maui, it's very special because there's really only one good place to surf on the island, really, and that's here. And it's not even that good a place to surf most of the time. And it's also the best place to windsurf. And so it's a real conflict.
Oh, Europeans? Yeah, they really suck.
Windsurfing is a much more international sport, and we travel the whole year around, and we know the sport is popular in other places, and we understand a lot more of the different cultures. And here, most of these people are from here. They were born here. They've never been away from Hawaii, and they really have no concept of anything outside of Hawaii. And so they think, this is my beach, and these guys should go home. And, you know, it's a little bit of an ignorance problem.
The women get ready for their last and decisive wave performance of the year as Hoogkeeper's first winter swells arrive on cue to play their part in what has to be the most dramatic wave performance of the year. Angela Cochran wins in her home break, but the Wave Performance World Championship of 1990 goes to Natalie Siebel from Germany. The pressure is on for Bjørn Dunkerbeck, as everybody is expecting him to be the first ever non-Hawaiian to win a wave event at Hoogkeeper. Robbie Nash, after a season of ups and downs, is very determined to retain his Wave Performance World title, which means he has to win the Aloha Classic. Kid on the block, Jason Polakow from Australia, defeats Bjørn Dunkerbeck for third place with his wild and unpredictable style of wave riding. Fourth place here, nevertheless, gives Dunkerbeck the Wave Performance World title, thus completing his hat-trick in all three World Tour disciplines last year. In the final of the Peter Stuyvesant Travel Aloha Classic, local hotshot Rush Randall won in a split decision against Nash.
Yeah, we could hear the boards Bjorn is using in the World Cup. Yeah, two boards here. One is made for course racing. That's obviously the bigger one. It's used with bigger sails and lighter winds. The difference between the course race slalom board and the regular, normal slalom board is in the bottom shape mainly and the size. The course race we got here is fairly big in volume. It's 2.75 meters long, which is 9 feet. Basically, they've got the really straight rock line, got the Pantheon bottom shape with this little edge here, and got the fairly steep rail. The main object we have is tracking upwind really well, since when you're first up at the upwind mark, you're gone, and the other guys see only the tail of your board. And the slalom board, which we got here, the main objective you have is control, since the jibes are really important. So the rail of the board is much softer. That doesn't get you off track once you're in the jibe. I mean, going fast in a straight line is really easy. I mean, everybody can do it, but if you're able to carry that speed through your turns, obviously you have an advantage. And Bjorn is pretty good at it. The pros immediately travel to the South Pacific for what is the first stop on the 1991 PBA World Tour, the DOH Sheraton Noumea Cup in New Caledonia, an $80,000 slalom event. In total, 10 rounds of slalom are held, with Anders Bringdal and Bjorn Dunkerbeck carrying on as they left off last season, breathing down each other's neck most of the time, and each wins 5 finals. Bjorn is the most consistent, never out of the top two, and thus taking the title. Even after 10 rounds of intense slalom racing, the DOH Sheraton Noumea Cup continues with a spectacular long distance race. Five miles of flat-out speed across the warm South Pacific waters are just what the doctor ordered for Bjorn Dunkerbeck, who wins with a 4-minute margin. Back to Almenar Yers for the Fanatic Tessier PBA Grand Slam,
where we're still waiting for wind. No reason for panic yet, though, because to complete all three disciplines, only 2.5 days of good wind are enough, but since the wind is such a fickle element, the contest lasts for 10 days. During this time, the otherwise barren beach of Almanar is transformed into a huge windsurf village. The wind picks up just enough for the course race discipline to start. Bjorn Dunkerbeck has the best start of the season as he immediately wins his first course race with a large margin.
I was very excited because I had been away for 2 months. I hadn't seen anybody of the racers in a long time. I didn't know what they'd been doing, what the sails, the equipment looked like. I just knew exactly what I had. I was used to my equipment, my boards, my sails. I all had sailed them before. So I knew exactly what my speed was going to be. I didn't know what the other guy had done. So I was very excited.
This is Katie.
Hi.
Bjorn Dunkerbeck proves that he's got the right form and the right equipment as he wins all four course races here in Almanar in front of Patrice Belbioff from France, Torkil Christensen from Denmark, Robert Tritihau from France, Manolo Barlet from New Caledonia, and Robbie Nash, who has to settle for sixth place only. In the women's course race, it's very close, with Jutta Müller, Britt Dunkerbeck and Jessica Crisp each winning a race. But in the last and decisive course race, Jessica loses it, with Britt Dunkerbeck taking the advantage. from the grey Mediterranean winter to the warm turquoise waters of the Caribbean for the Barbados Windsurfing World Cup earlier this year. With a prize money fund of just $25,000 divided over slalom and wave performance, the Barbados Windsurfing World Cup is not a very important event, but it's sure one of the funnest. And thanks to the ideal sailing condition, it's a great warm-up for the start of the season. Men's slalom final, Germany's Bernd Flesner, defending his title here in Barbados, has a great start. Flesner leads from start to finish, and the 22-year-old windsurfer from Norderney in the north of Germany starts in only his second year as a professional. He's definitely a name to watch for the future. Besides the good sailing conditions, another great attraction of Barbados for any windsurfer is the totally laid-back atmosphere. Dora Bria from Brazil is one of the few South American competitors on the world tour. And with her fluid style of wave riding, she takes first prize at the expense of Francesca Salvati and Kelly Moore.
Run.
Robbie Seeger from Germany, ranked 9th in the PBA Wave Performance ranking list, is eliminated by rookie Lars Petersen from Denmark. Petersen almost matches Seeger in the jumping bracket, but the young Dane totally surprises his opponent with his incredible tricks and transitions. First final brings Italian grace against German power. Cesare Cantagalli, I-99, versus Bernd Flesner, G-16. Barbados Windsurfing World Cup was blessed with good wind and waves every day. Therefore, a total of 2 double elimination series were completed. This means that 4 finals were sailed, with Cantagalli winning each one.
Everybody was waiting for you to do the double loop, because it was, the conditions were almost perfect for that, we think. But why didn't you manage to pull it off? What was the reason?
Well, I've been looking for it the whole day. I mean, every ways I had, every chance I had, I was ready for it. But the condition have just not been ready for it.
Shake it up. Thank you.
Cesari has the edge over Flessner in this last and final, but seems to be looking for more. Conditions look ideal for the double loop, and Cesari must be determined to pull it off for the first time ever in competition.
I saw a very nice swell coming out from the outside, and as I was pumping through the white water, I just hit downwind and tried to get as much speed as I could. As I hit the first the lip, I shit in very hard, and as I was realizing how high I was going, I just decided to go for the second time, and it was quite successfully. It was the first time that I ever did a double in a wave contest, and I'm very happy about it. I'm very happy I won this event, and I'm very happy.
This is a Proto 1992 Wave Pro, and compared to 91, the look is quite similar, but if you were to study the design, actually, it's a bit different. We've taken the luff curve up a bit, we've shortened the luff a little bit, we took the head batten in a little bit, we flattened the head a little bit.
Shorter boom.
With a slightly shorter boom, slightly fuller in the bottom, and the biggest difference, single difference, is that the Wave Pro for 91 had the monofilm panels coming down under this batten all the way down to the tack batten. And it's important that a wave sail be durable, especially in the foot, because as you're tumbling in the white water, the nose of the board can find the sail. If you have monofilm down here, it can be destroyed easily. But this design that from ART has the PVC in the foot and the normal mylar, these reinforcements as well, keeping the bottom of the sail very, very durable, and putting monofilm, which is light and stretch resistant, in the top of the sail, keeping the sail light and performant.
It's finally happening.
Gosh, it looks like a different beach.
yeah, finally. It's a little bumpy, but it's fine. And I finally got waves, got wind, so it's gonna happen.
I'm a little bit nervous here because I've never sailed this break before, and now it's very, very big and very, very light.
Oh, waves are killer. Wind's a bit up and down, but I think it'll be good. No question about it.
I'm glad that the waves came and the wind is picking up, because they really work hard for this event.
We always prove ourselves in the last minute. That's the Puerto Rican way, I guess.
It's gonna be exciting. It's gonna be a matter of being in the right place at the right time.
Let's wait till the last minute and then get it done in awesome fashion. How's that sound?
But hopefully the conditions will stay up with us long enough so we can get it completed. Hope so, looks fun. Light wind, big surf, shallow water, a lot of reef. Yeah.
After a week of hanging around on the beach, waiting for the wind and waves, the final day of the Ray-Ban Killer Loop Wave Blast in Puerto Rico produces some of the gnarliest surf ever encountered at a World Cup event. It's sheer survival. Already back in the 60s, many surfers found their way to Puerto Rico's northwestern shores in search for the perfect wave. Now, also some of the world's keenest wave-shredding windsurfers have discovered Puerto Rico's amazing swells. The secret of this break is the Puerto Rican trough just outside the reef. With its depth of 8 kilometers, it allows the ocean swells to reach the reef unhindered, thus breaking at full power on a very shallow reef, alive with sea urchins and poisonous coral. This is by all means a hardcore spot. In the first semi-final, Hawaiian-based Japanese wave-sailing virtuoso Hidemi Furuya meets local hero Rick Villanueva. Villanueva is defending event champion and widely regarded as Puerto Rico's top talent. Furuya depends on his extensive experience as a pro contender to meet Villanueva's aggression and style with calculated moves and smart tactics. We'll be right back. In the second semi-final, Dave Kalama, one of the world's most spectacular wave sailors, encounters Hawaiian sailmaker Jeff Henderson, a relative outsider. Kalama's on a big wave, but he's not charging, just playing it safe. And he kicks out. It's probably a smart move, because once you take a wave like that all the way in, it could be tough getting back out again. And now it's Henderson on a wave. Ugh, eats it big time.
You've got to deal with what you're dealt right at that specific time. If the lip throws out far and it looks like it's good for an aerial, then that's what you should do. If it doesn't pitch out at all, you've got to do a nice cutback and hope that it resets up for an aerial off the lip. But you've got to just basically be prepared to do anything at any time.
Why not? Let's go.
And now we're in the final of the Ray-Ban Killer Loop Wave Blast.
Huge waves and light wind. These guys are risking their lives for the prizes here. Dave Kalama, first jibe on his way in. He's on a nice little wave. Something you hear hope. Nice lollipop again. And Furuya right behind him. Both of them pumping like crazy, and Kalama kicks out, looks for a better wave. Furuya on a nice logo high wave. Fading, ready for a bottom turn. Bottom turns. Goes straight for a lip. Nice wave ride. Furuya doing all the tricks. Dave Kalama on a major wave on the outside. Watch him disappear on the other side of this baby. Look at the size of this set, everybody. These are 20-foot faces out there. Dave Kalama on a huge wave on the outside. Oh my God, this is incredible. Kicks out, really smart guy, I would say. Dave Kalama with plenty of speed, forward loop. Furuya is basically dead on the water on the inside. Dave Kalama, bottom turning on a pretty small wave. Forward loop on his way in, incredible. This guy's scoring some pretty awesome points. That's not easy to do. Dave Kalama showing why he's the highest rated board sailor in Puerto right here, right now. Number 6 in the world. Forward loop. Body drag on the way. Whoa, nice lollipop. Top turn. Nice little, tiny little cutback. Bottom turn, goes for the lip. Just doing some wave riding and tough jibes out of that wave. Peruya way to the left, working his way out. Huge wave. He's bottom turning, he goes for the lip on a wave of probably three times. Twice my size. Bottom turns, lay down. Top turn, this guy's really ripping it up. He's got guts. Another bottom turn, goes to the top and off the lip, very nice, and eats it. And he's still up. He pulls it out of the soup, and he's still riding. Another top turn off the lip. That's the end of that heat. Pretty soon, we know officially who's the winner, but I think everybody knows out here on the beach, Dave Kalama has kicked some pretty major ass.
I told myself when I first got outside, don't go back inside. Whatever you do, just don't go back inside. And a few times you get so tempted because you're on such a nice wave, but you gotta stay with your plan, and I think it paid off.
Oh, Dave was different already. I got sick of it. I'm happy to be sick of it.
Back to Almenar for the slalom discipline of the Fanatic Tessier PBA Grand Slam. $50,000 at stake in this discipline, and we're moving right into the women's final. That's held under very difficult conditions, just after sunset. Immediately, Britt Dunkovic takes a firm lead, arousing suspicion that she's using night vision equipment. But more than good eyes, it's her physical strength and mental determination that gives Britt that leading edge. Her drive to win is probably only matched by her brother, Bjorn. Elisabeth Coquel from France, with sail number F31, is in second place, closely followed by Andrea Hoppner, G54, and Jutta Müller, G680, both from Germany. The latter comes out of the jibe best, as she fanatically chases Elisabeth Coquel to the last mark. Meanwhile, Britt Dunkerbeck is already on her way to the finish, seemingly untouched by these cold and miserable conditions.
I had a good start and I was first at the mark, and it means a lot in gusty winds like this in flat water. If you're already first at the mark, it's difficult to lose your first place actually, unless you do mistakes.
In the men's final, only four competitors start because all eight sailors, including Bjorn Dunkerbeck, have been disqualified for jumping the start gun in a semi-final. Anders Bringdal has the best start and rounds the first mark with a big lead. Behind him, rookie Manolo Barlet outwits the more experienced local favourite, Eric Thiem. American outsider Micah Bazianas is fourth at the mark. And at the second mark, Bringdal's lead is well over 100 metres. Thiem is still in third, trying to catch up with Barlet, who is going very fast, approximately 55 kilometres per hour. But so is Bringdal, who enjoys a very comfortable lead by now of almost 150 metres. With just one jibe mark to go before the finish, the Swede seems sure of his first victory of the season. And as Bazianas rounds the mark in fourth and last position, Bringdal already crosses the finishing line to win this year's first Grand Slam slalom event.
I went through the whole thing winning every heat, and unfortunately on the semi-final on the other side, everybody got disqualified for premature start, which is nice for me because obviously we had a final with four people only, but on the other hand it would have been nice to race them as well to see who's there, but then again there's only that much gentleman sport anyway, so I mean if you get it handed to you, you grab it.
And now for something completely different, windsurfing indoors. For the second time, all top PBA professionals took their equipment to Paris, to a huge pool of 80 by 30 meters, blasted by 26 gigantic wind machines, pumping out 25 knots of artificial wind. It's the Swatch Fundor in the world-renowned Bercy Sports Stadium. 3 nights in a row, Bercy Stadium is sold out. In total, 30,000 spectators pay a handsome fee to watch the top stars in action. Two disciplines here in Bercy, slalom and jumping. In the women's slalom, Britt Dunkovic outsmarts French favourite Nathalie Lelièvre. But in the men's slalom, Eric Thiem delights the French crowd by winning an intense slalom just in front of Bjorn Dunkerbeck. The jumping is outrageous. Using a very strange takeoff ramp, the competitors managed not only to pull off the most amazing jumps, but also to destroy well over $10,000 worth of high-tech equipment. Jessica Crisp amazes the spectators and herself with some beautiful one-handed tabletop jumps, thus winning the women's bracket. And her compatriot Jason Polakow wins the jumping discipline by showing sheer perfection in pulling off forward loops. We'll be right back. out for the next PBA World Tour magazine tape that features the new world speed sailing records in Saint-Marie de la Mer, France, and in Tarifa, Spain. Big waves at the Marie O'Neill Invitational at Arequipa, Maui. Gale force winds in Omazaki, hard slalom action in the Caribbean, and incredible wave action at Diamond Head, Oahu. Then there's the Canarian Tour, Germany, Holland, and of course, the Peter Stuyvesant Travel Aloha Classic, the final event of the 1991 PBA World Tour. Besides that, we'll feature the latest developments in equipment and sailing techniques, and a close look-up at some of the world's best windsurfers. It's a sheer must for any windsurf enthusiast.